I'm Dr. Jim Demers, assistant principal here at Falmouth High School, and this event is being sponsored by the Falmouth Police Department and the school department. I'd like to begin the event by letting everyone on stage introduce themselves and what role they play on the committee. We'll start with my far left, Tom McManaman.
Hi, I'm Tom McManaman, assistant principal at Falmouth High School for ninth grade and for academic programs.
Hi, I'm Laura Finton, the school adjustment counselor at Falmouth High School.
I'm Jeffrey Smith, I'm a captain at the Falmouth Police Department.
Jamie Livingston, school resource officer for the high school and the Lawrence Junior High.
I'm Patty Mitro-Costas, I'm the director of prevention for Gosnold on Cape Cod.
I'm Jim Butcher, I'm the chief probation officer in the Barnstable District Court.
And I'm Edward Dunn, the police chief here in Falmouth.
Well, welcome and thank you for taking your time tonight to join us. I'm going to begin with Jim Butcher, who is going to be our guest speaker, and he's going to speak to us from a parent perspective tonight. Jim?
Thank you, Jim. As Jim said, I'm speaking to you on a parent's perspective. Even though I'm the chief probation officer in Barnstable, I'm not here as a probation officer tonight. I am here as a parent. Next month, on April 20th, will be 9-year anniversary of when my daughter, Courtney, was killed in a car crash in the town of Leicester. Originally, I'm from Worcester, and we moved down here 3 years ago when I got the job. Courtney was a light in my life. She was born May 21st, 1988. Her mom and I had issues, and we were divorced when she was about two, and I did all the father things. I never missed a visit with her. I lived about 5 minutes away from her, so I was able to see her a little more. She played youth sports. I was always at her games, even when it wasn't my night or my weekend. So as a result, I had a tremendous relationship with her right up until the night she was killed. Courtney went to Doherty High School in Worcester, where she played basketball and lacrosse. During her junior year, she asked me if I could, she actually told me she thought she wanted to be an athletic trainer. So we talked about it, and she went up to, I was at the time officiating Division I college football, and I had a scrimmage up at UNH. And she came up with me, and just for the ride, her and her brother, and they acted like they were ball boys on the sidelines and ball people. And she took a little tour of the campus herself and really liked it. And at the time, I was talking to a guy by the name of Chip Kelly, who is now the head coach of the San Francisco 49ers. And Chip was telling me, asking me about some recruits and asking me about the kids and, you know, what Courtney wanted to do. And I told him, he goes, this is one of the best schools in the country for athletic training. So I told Courtney that, and she liked what she saw, and she did a lot of research online, and she went to other schools with her mother, but it kept coming back to UNH, so that's what she wanted to do. In her senior year, I was able to set her up in an internship at Holy Cross where she could leave school and work with the athletic training staff, and that just convinced her that that's what she wanted to do in college, and she was able to get a lot of great relationships with the kids at Holy Cross. They really took her under her wing like she was a little sister, and as a result, we still have relationships with some of these young people today. So Courtney was off to school at UNH. She applied early decision. She was a National Honor Society student, and she got in. Fall 2006, we moved her up there, and she was off. In April 2007, she gave me a call on a Monday night and for a couple of things, and one was I took her off her car insurance. She was on my car insurance, mine and my wife's. And she said, Dad, can you put me back on? And I said, why? Well, what's going on? She said, I said, you got 3 weeks left of school. She said, well, if you put me back on, I can take grandma's car back up here, their extra car, and I can move myself back in the next 3 weeks. That way you and mom don't have to take time off, and, you know, I can just move myself back and still have a car up here to use. And I said, all right. I said, well, I said, I can't get you Friday. I have to go to the Cape and actually to the house I live in now in Dennis, my mom's house at the time. And I said, she goes, well, that's okay, Dad. You know, I was the last piece of the puzzle, evidently, because she had arranged a ride for my sister to pick her up from UNH, and then my mother and her brother to go up and pick her up at Chelmsford, where my sister lives. So I was the last piece of the puzzle. I mean, that was okay. But and she said, I want to tell you something else, Dad. I got seats in the monster seats in Fenway Park on Sunday night. I said, that's great. And she goes, well, you never sat there. And I said, no, I haven't. She was busting me a little. I said, but I said, you're going to have to tell me all about it. So she came in Friday. She called me about 5:30. And we talked for a while. And I was with my brother-in-law and my friend Joe Rosick. And I said, what are you doing tonight? She said, we're going out to Brian's house. And that was Joe's son, Brian, and his wife was going to be there. So they went out there. We all watched the Red Sox game. It was a weekend series with the Yankees. So great, awesome game. And Coco Crisp gets a hit off Mariano Rivera, bottom of the ninth, Red Sox win. So I called Courtney. It's 20 past 11. And I said, what a game, huh? She says, yeah, Dad, monster seats Sunday night. I said, I know. And we talked for a while. I said, you know, can we go tomorrow to have some dinner? I said, you know, she was taking my mother to a baby shower, and then she was going to go back to school. I said, you know, we'll be home about 2:30 or so. I said, I'd just like to take you to dinner and see you for a while. I said, I promise you'll be on the road early and back to UNH. And she says, yeah, Dad, that sounds great. So I said, I love you, Court. And she said, yeah, I know, Dad. She was in front of her friends, and she didn't want to not be cool. And I was okay with that. I'd heard it many times from her. And I figured I'd hear it tomorrow, the following day. So we went to bed, and about 1:30 that morning, on Saturday morning, Joe Rosick wakes me up saying, oh my God, no, don't say that. And I don't know, Joe's having a bad dream or what. I go in the adjacent bedroom, and he hands me a cell phone. And it's his wife, Cheryl. And she says, Jimmy, there's been a crash. There's fatalities. Courtney and Brian were in the car. And I says, you know, what are they telling you? Are they saying how many? You know, where is it? And she says, it's down the street. I don't know. They only went to get an ice cream. So I tried calling my wife. I couldn't get a hold of her. I tried calling my ex-wife. She was away in Pennsylvania. My ex-wife's a teacher. My present wife's a teacher. Me marrying teachers, I couldn't tell you what, but I married two of them. So second one's working a lot better. But anyway, I couldn't get a hold of my wife at first. And while I'm saying this, Joe's packing up his stuff. He's out the door. So Joe and I had nothing to drink. And my brother-in-law gets up, and he had a couple beers. And he says, I'm going. It's Courtney. I said, no, you can't, Derek. I said, look, stay here. Lock the house up for me. As soon as I know something, I'll call you. So I was off on the road. I'm going up 495, and Joe's about 10 minutes ahead of me. Still trying to get a hold of my wife, my ex-wife, whatever I can do. And Joe calls me, and he says, my wife did get a hold of me, and she said, I said, where are you? She said, I'm at the Leicester police station. I said, who's there? She said, Cheryl's here. She said, Nate's mom and Julie's parents. And I said, well, what are they telling you? Are they telling you anything? She goes, no, they're not saying anything. So I'm driving along a little further, and Joe calls me, and I'm just a little below Foxborough on 495, and he says, Jimmy, Brian's dead. And I says, oh, my God, Joe. I said, I'm so sorry. He says, there's four dead, one survivor. He said, I'm praying that survivor's your daughter. And I said, well, I'm praying it's her too, Joe. I said, but her eyes just went down. So I kept driving, and I'm saying to myself, I said, four kids, four sets of parents, my little girl's dead. And my head's telling me one thing, my heart's saying, she's not even 19 years old. She's a great kid. She makes good decisions. She can't be dead, you know. And head's telling me one thing, heart's telling me another. So I get to the Mass Pike interchange at 495 and the Mass Pike, and my wife calls me again, and she says, where are you? And I told her, and I said, is she alive or dead? And she says, Jim, they don't want me to tell you. I said, is she alive or dead? I want to know if my little girl is alive or dead. And she says, she didn't make it. So I got very emotional about it, as you could might guess, and I still do when I think about it. And I got to the Leicester police station, and my friend, who was the chief at the time, Jim Hurley, still a chief, and comes out and says, they said she was a great kid. Was. She is a great kid. But he was right, because she was now the late Courtney Butcher. And I finally got a hold of her mother, who never got to say goodbye to her, who had to drive back 12 hours through Pennsylvania and, you know, was an emotional wreck, as you can imagine. And we had to get together and decide what we were going to do. And on Monday, her mother asked me if I'd go down and identify her body. So I called them. They shipped her body to Boston. And I called them, and I said, I said my name, and I said, I'm coming down. They said, well, we're going to show you pictures. I says, I'm not looking at your pictures. I want to see my little girl. And they said, well, sir, we don't do that. This is what I says, look, you want to release the body? I said, I work in law enforcement. I want to see my little girl. They said, can we call you back? I said, yep. So they called me back about 5 minutes later, and they said, sir, what we can do is we can wheel her up in front of a window. If you could identify her from there, that's the best we could do. If, you know, you understand that there's other bodies and rights of privacy in the morgue and you can't go into it. I said, all right, I can deal with that. So my wife and I went in there and they wheeled her up, and she had bruising over her eyes, down her nose, and under her eyes. And I found out later that was where she hit the headrest and pushed it through the window. They hit with such force. And it was her, and I wanted to touch her. I wanted to just say, come on, Court, wake up, let's go. You know, let's get out of here. And I couldn't touch her one more time. And I will forever remember the face of what was on her face. And she was wrapped in a big sheet, and I didn't know why, because I was never told till later what the cause of death was. And it was basically internal, tremendous bleeding. She bled out, essentially. She was almost cut in half by the door when the car hit the tree. And we got her back to the funeral home, and my wife and I looked at her, and I said, it doesn't look like my Courtney. And her mother went in, and I said, look, I said, Kathy, I said, to me it doesn't look like her. I said, we'll make a joint decision when you come out, what you want to do. And she went in, and she came out, she agreed with me, and she says, we're going to have a closed casket. I said, that's fine. And we did, and we went through a 8-hour funeral procession, or a wake, supposed to go 4 to 7. People were there at 3:30. We didn't get out of there until after 11 o'clock at night. We had a funeral the next day where there were so many people that they couldn't all get in the church. And then we had the long funeral line, and we had to go through all that. And there were still cars at the church, and we were at the cemetery. And then it goes away because, you know, people have to go on with their lives. And you're left wondering, could this have been prevented? Should this have happened or not? I mean, it obviously shouldn't have happened. But when I was on the phone with Courtney that night, I said to my friend Joe Ross, I guess, Court, what are you doing? She goes, well, we're going out to get an ice cream. And I knew there was no drinking at the time. And I said, you know, who's driving? And she said, well, Nate and this guy. And I got off the phone, Brian and Julie and Lauren, and I said, Joe, that kid, Nate, worries me. And he said, oh, no, he's a great kid. He's this, that. He says, Joe, all I know is every time there's a problem, that kid's around. And call a probation officer intuition or law enforcement intuition, you kind of know when there's a problem kid there. And for all intents and purposes, Nate was not a bad kid, but Nate was always one finding the parties and everything else. And the next day, Joe said to me, how'd you know he was going to kill our kids? I said, I didn't know that, Joe. I said, I just know he concerned me, and I wish I had sent more to my daughter. And, you know, hindsight's always 20/20, but that's one I wish I had been wrong about. As a result of this, my family went through a very, very difficult time, as you can imagine. My ex-wife and I had a big blowout about a month after the funeral. We no longer speak. My wife took to blaming herself, as everybody did in the family, kind of, except for the youngest. But my wife said, why didn't I tell her she was coming in at, you know, she should be in at midnight? I says, Carrie, I said, you know, you think she comes in at midnight when she's out at UNH? I said, you know, she comes in when she wants to. She made good decisions. I said, she had no control over this. And my son, who was with them, left a half hour or so before they went out, because he had to work the next day, and he said, I could have stopped it. I says, Colin, what if we lost you too? He says, no, I could have stopped it. And what happened when they were driving, and they were driving fast, and the girls were scared and screaming, they said, they called my son, and he was a big kid. He was an offensive lineman at St. John's High School. He was a big, strong kid, and he threatened Nate over the phone, Nate Plaza, who was the driver. And Nate blew it off. He says, Nate, slow down, or when I find you, I'm going to kill you. He's like, yeah, sure, Colin, big joke. Hangs up. 5 minutes later, four or five kids were dead. So Colin carried that with him for a long time because he lost his best friend and his sister in the same crash. I have a daughter, Mary Kate, who I was just talking to Ms. Ganser about, and she's a junior at Seton Hall University now. And at the time, she was a fifth grader. And she'd just go off on her own, and I'd find her crying. And I'm like, you know, MK, what are you, you know, you all right? What's, she goes, Dad, I miss Courtney. I says, we all miss her, honey. I says, we're just gonna, you know, we tried to get her some counseling. She didn't want it. She went through it in her own way, but it took her a good year or so to get through it. And then I have Patricia, who was at the time a kindergartner, is now a freshman over at DY. And, you know, she'd always be crying, and she'd cry at school, and this happened for a good couple, 2 or 3 years. And it would just be around dates with Courtney and around other things about Courtney. And, you know, I finally got her to stop in a lot of ways, but I said, you know who made Courtney laugh more than anybody? And she said, no, I said, you did. I said, she loved you so much. I said, and you can't keep doing this, Trish. I said, you know, we've got to move forward. And I said, you got to have your best memories of Courtney you can have. And we try to just help her move forward. And it's not an easy thing. But these are some of the things that family goes through when somebody drives like an idiot. And that's what this kid did that night. And Courtney was seated behind the driver. Seated next to her was a girl named Julie Karen, who was going to Anna Maria on a basketball, academic basketball scholarship. She was a tremendous basketball player, 1,000-point scorer at North Brookfield High School, and a beautiful girl. And as pretty as she was a better kid. And her and Courtney had played AAU together, and they met that night at Brian's house because they always get together when she came home. And Julie had a closed casket. Next to her was Brian Rossick, and that was my friend Joe's son and my son Colin's best friend at St. John's. And Brian was about 5'5", no neck. He worked out all the time, played for Paul, my son, but he didn't play very much, but he was on the team. And Brian was going to Assumption College on an academic scholarship, pre-med. Brian was going to be a radiologist. And the force of the car hit so hard, Brian broke his neck. He had an open casket, but his neck was broken. That's how Brian was killed. Seated in the front seat was a girl named Lauren Bennett. And Lauren was also a phenomenal basketball player. She was going to Curry College to play basketball. And Lauren suffered a brain injury. And she was in a coma for 2 months, and she has no short-term memory now. She she had to finish her senior year at North Brookfield, and she had to go another semester. Went to Curry College in January of 2008 and just couldn't handle the work because of the brain injury. She couldn't remember anything. You look at her today, she looks every bit as normal. She's a very beautiful girl. She still keeps in contact with my son, Colin. But she has no short-term memory. Driver of the car, as I said, was a kid named Nate Plaza, and I have said in every talk I've ever made, Nate was not a bad kid, but Nate was a bit of a show-off, and Nate was a bit of the man who could find the parties and everything else. And Nate was doing 80 miles an hour in a 30 on a country road in Leicester, and I've seen roads like this all over Cape Cod. And as I said, my son threatened him in the car to slow down. He came down, he went across a causeway, lost control, and he T-boned an oak tree, and he hit it so hard that flipped the car around to the other side. You know, Nate had gotten a ticket the fall before that, because I did some digging and I wanted to find out a little more about him. And at the time, Melanie's Law had not been enacted. It was enacted in April 1st of 2007. And if it had been on the books, Nate would have lost his license for 3 months. He would have, six months, and paid a $500 fine, had to do the SCAR program, and alive at 25. Nate didn't have to do any of that. He just was found responsible. His insurance went up. You know, I think about Nate because I think about his little brother and what happened to him. And this is the part where the kids don't think, A, they think they're invincible. They think they're bulletproof. And B, you don't realize the consequences of what happens when you drive like this and you do other things outside the realm that you think is safe or it's cool and it's not. And Nate had a little brother who used to get hate mail on his Facebook account. He used to get people mailed him letters. You know, what kind of brother do you have? You know, your brother killed my friend. Your brother did this. What did this kid do? He did nothing but idolize his big brother, who was a good athlete, was going to Springfield College to play soccer and hopefully baseball, and was, by all accounts, a pretty good kid, but he was a show-off. This kid did nothing, yet he got all this vitriol from people in the Brookfields and everything, and it wasn't right, and he didn't do anything to deserve that. But these are the things that you leave behind when you drive like an idiot like this and when you are irresponsible and you kill somebody, including yourself. And I've never forgiven Nate Plaza, and I don't. And people say, well, you have to. Joe Rosick told me I have to. He's dead. I said, you want to forgive him, Joe? You go right ahead. I said, he took your son. You want to forgive him for that? You can. I said, I don't forgive him for taking my little girl. And I tell all the kids when I see him, you know, you're always daddy's little girl. You know, you could be 40 years old, have 5 kids, still your daddy's little girl. And because of that kid, I can't walk her down the aisle. I can't hold a grandchild from Courtney. And so that's why I don't forgive him. And I think if people think a little more like that and try to remember what we're trying to accomplish in a night like this, is that you want to give your kids some freedom. You want to be able to be the cool parent sometimes and say, you know, yeah, you can take the car, yeah, you can do this. But you've got to put limits on things. And it's not like when we were kids, you know, the social media, everything going on with these kids. It's not the same thing. And it's, the cars are faster. The phones are always going. There's always something that takes these kids' attention away from either the driving or they're partying or whatever they're trying to do. And they may have a substance in them or anything. This night, these kids didn't have any substances in them other than ice cream. But the mere fact that he was showing off in a fast car cost 4 kids their lives and another kid her future. And these are the things parents need to take note of. And I hope that nights such as this, I wish we had a bigger crowd and I will see more people at the social host night, think about these things before you let this happen to your child. I speak at a lot of schools and I come to Falmouth because it's a special place, special administrators here and teachers and students. And I think they're worth it, and I hope they listen. And I hope that they take to heart when I get up and tell the story, because it'd be anything if I could do not to be here, because that would mean my daughter was alive. But she's not. And if I can prevent another family from going through this, well, then maybe I've done something. But I hope you all take it seriously, those of you who did come, and I hope you want to know who, what, and where when your kids go out, and who they're with, and what they're doing, and what time set a limit on them when they're coming home. And you know what? You may get them mad sometimes, and that's okay. You'd rather see them in that bed the next morning, because that's all I wanted to see with Courtney, instead of having to go identify her body. Thank you for your time.
Jim, thank you for sharing your story again with us. I know it's difficult. Chief Dunn?
Thank you. I really do wish there were more people here, but that's okay. We're here. And one of the main reasons we're here tonight is because of what's been going on in Falmouth as far as the increase in underage drinking parties. That's the main reason why we're here. This goes back to last summer. We investigated or got calls to at least 4 large underage drinking parties, and it concerned us. concerned us deeply because a lot of the times it was the same individuals at these different parties. And reached out to the superintendent with our concerns, and we decided that we needed to hold a forum to educate people, educate the parents. We did have a meeting at the police station with some parents that children were involved in some of these underage drinking parties. And some of the things that concerned me and still concerns me today is some of the, I mean, most of the parents, great. They understand, good parents. And you can raise your child any way you want, as I've raised mine. But one of the things that really concerned me was statements like, I don't care if they're at a party with alcohol, they're not going to drink. If they're at a party, they're youth. We've all been there. They make foolish mistakes. Hopefully they don't pick up the alcohol. But it really did concern me when I heard that. No adult supervision. If the alcohol's there, they're going to pick it up. And other bad things happen just because they're not drinking. We end up at these parties because there's fights, stabbings, sexual assaults, and it needs to be addressed. But we at the police department can't do it all. We need the parents' assistance and help. And as was said here, you want to give them some leeway. They're going to be heading off to college, and they're going to be making the decisions themselves, and you hope they make great decisions. I had a lot of sleepless nights when my daughter was in college. I'm sure you all did too, or will. But fortunately, she made great decisions. So anyways, that's why we're here tonight, to answer questions and get out the information that we have to try to keep your children safe. That's what it's all about.
Thank you, Chief. Patty?
Thank you, Jim. I'm here tonight from Gosnold on Cape Cod, and I think when people hear the word Gosnold, particularly lately, they think of the opiate crisis. And as a prevention professional, I'm always concerned that alcohol and marijuana have taken a backseat to the opiate crisis, but I'm here tonight, and I feel even if I get to one parent to say that it really all begins with alcohol. And I know, as both of you have just said, I think the perception of risk of alcohol has diminished greatly, particularly over the last couple of years. Kids who use alcohol at age 15 are 4 times more likely to become addicted than if they wait until they're 21. Most of our kids do experiment, so I think as parents we need to be vigilant. We can never be too vigilant. I sit here tonight, first and foremost, as a parent of a 23-year-old, and I say by the grace of God, his decisions have been great, but it takes one friend, one decision that will change lives forever. And it takes a community. I mean, how do we as a community get together? I think these places are a great, great place to start. We see families that are impacted every day. We have treatment centers that are chock full, that have waiting lists that people can't get into. Even our intensive outpatient programs are full. We have clinicians in 14 schools on the Cape, that's caseloads are full of children with mental health, anxiety, and substance abuse issues of their own and in their families. So I think we can't do it enough, we can't say it enough. The alcohol of today is not what it was when we grew up. There's Oreo-flavored vodka that's not marketed to 40-year-old men, it's marketed to our children. The alcohol contents are higher. Marijuana has at least 4 to 10 times the THC levels that it had when we were growing up. And we see the intensity of what it does and how it can be a gateway to other drug use. I don't think we have anybody in our treatment centers for opiate use that didn't start with alcohol. So I think if that's the message that I can get to the parents tonight, I mean, I can go on and on about stats and such, but I think just to keep in mind that it's not just alcohol. Alcohol is a starting point. And as I've told my son over and over again, and I repeatedly tell him today, that it never ends well when alcohol is involved excessively, and particularly with underage drinking. Good decisions aren't made, things happen, and things that you can't take back. So thank you. Any questions, I'm happy to answer.
Thank you. One of the messages that the health teachers give here to our students is a lot of times our students will ask, what is the most addictive drug? And the answer the health teachers give the students are, whatever you're doing. If you're smoking cigarettes right then and there, that's the most addictive drug that you're dealing with. If you're drinking, it's alcohol. If it's marijuana, it's marijuana. So whatever you're doing, that is the most addictive drug at the time for that student. And that's the message that I'm hoping parents will also send to their kids. I'm going to move to the next table. I'll let that panel add what supports they have in place here at school or in the community, and then I'll open it up to questions in the audience. Officer Livingston?
Being in the school, I'm able to be available to the students. If they have questions, I'm able to help them make better decisions that can help them not have to have a negative interaction with me or other police officers. I work closely with the adjustment counselors and with the administration, just as a tool, as a resource, and as a liaison between the PD and the schools.
Well, my role tonight was to talk about the social host law. What is it? What are the repercussions for you as a parent and a homeowner if you decide to have a party at your house? Or if your child decides to have a party at your house without you knowing? Well, Chapter 138, Section 34 deals with furnishing alcohol to minors, and it's been a law that's been on the books forever and a day. But over a decade ago, they changed one word in that law, and they put the word or allow. Furnishing, prior to the word allow being in there, only meant supply, give, and provide alcohol to someone under 21. By adding the word allow, it changed the game forever. So if you're home and your kids are down in the basement and they have some friends over and they sneak booze in through the slider in your basement, you could be held responsible and criminally charged for that because it's your house, it's under your control, you should have known what was going on in your house. And so what is the punishment for something like that? Well, it's up to 1 year in jail or a $2,000 fine. So I don't think there's anyone in this room that wants to pony up $2,000 for their kid to have a couple of beers in the basement with their buddies. So I just want to have you keep that in mind that, you know, some people think it's a safer choice to have the kids come to the house, throw the keys in a basket, and let them have at it with alcohol. But you're on the hook for it. It's not worth it. So just keep that in mind when it comes to teenagers in your home. You're legally only allowed, believe it or not, to have your own child or a grandchild consume alcohol in your home if you decide that you want to do that. You are not able to allow anyone else to drink alcohol that's under 21 in your own home. Thank you.
As the school adjustment counselor here at the high school, I'm here to support the students who come to me as well as parents who may call with concerns that their child has been drinking. If there's one thing that I want to say tonight to the parents, over and over again, it's that these behaviors are not starting in high school. These behaviors are starting much, much earlier than we've ever seen. Some reports are as young as 9, 10 years old. At the high school, we're hearing about them. We're supporting students in whatever services or resources they need by connecting them with places such as Gosnold or private therapists or even rehab, and we're working with parents and with community members to get the students the services that they need. Anyone can give us a call to get some services or to have one of the adjustment counselors meet with their student to see what it is that they need or what's going on.
Speaking on behalf of school administration, and I think I'll echo a lot of what you've heard already so far this evening, I think what you see is a real team approach from Falmouth High School. Administration, counselors, the police officers in our schools really working together to support what we believe is in the best interest of the students here at Falmouth, of the kids here at Falmouth. From the academic perspective, students at Falmouth High School are offered health classes, as Dr. Demers alluded to, that really work hard to educate them on the risks, the dangers of these types of behaviors at this age. And I think you've heard it already tonight, but we can do so much. We can tell them what the dangers are, we can show them the data, we can tell the stories, but I think the greatest message comes from home. And so again, we're a team up here, and I think from the school perspective, we want to be a team with the parents of the community as well. Thank you.
Chief?
Yeah, just so that you have an understanding, as far as the police department's policy on underage drinking, we had a policy that was developed in 2002, and it's still in effect today. Let me just read the purpose of the policy, and then I'll get into the discretions that we give our officers. The purpose of the policy is to establish a uniform procedure to guide police officers in investigating incidents involving the possession, consumption, transportation, or procuring of alcohol by a person under the age of 21. And like I say, it's a guide for our officers. The officers, at his or her discretion, have the following options consistent with Massachusetts general law. We can arrest. We can summons. Town bylaw citations. Place them in protective custody if they're intoxicated. A parental notification, mandatory. This is where the discretion goes. It's mandatory if it's someone under the age of 18. We contact the parents. And that's what we try to do in all these instances, is contact the parents. We either have the parents come to the police station or have the parents come to the scene. We don't want your child to have a record. It can affect them with their college or anything like that, but sometimes they're leaving us no choice. And we really do get very, very concerned at these parties, especially when they, in the wintertime, when they start running and fleeing into the woods, because now we have another situation. We have all these kids that we're dealing with here, but now we're also concerned about the ones that are out in the woods, passed out or cold or things like that. So it really does turn into a mess. But we can't do it alone. The school can't do it alone. In the treatment, we need the parents' help. And like I said, most of the time, parents are very, very good. And you want your children to be safe. I know you do. And those sitting here tonight, I'm sure do, because you're here trying to get information. We also have Falmouth is fortunate enough, we got a $10,000 underage drinking grant. The state feels it's a concern because they have a grant. And what that is we will be deploying officers on weekends, especially around prom season, around vacations, to target all those party spots that we will be going out, inspecting them, checking. We'll also be checking parking lots of liquor establishments for youth trying to purchase alcohol and for adults purchasing alcohol for youth. And we will take the appropriate action on that. We really do try to keep your children safe, but we can't do it alone, and that's why we had this forum, and we'd like to just be able to answer any questions and get your help. Absolutely, it's a topic should be discussed more, and you know, I applaud all the parents that are here tonight. And that is the scary part of it all. It's a sad thing to say, and I don't like saying it, but it's going to take a tragedy to fill this auditorium.
And that's basically what I try to tell them. I mean, my daughter did make good decisions, and she was still killed. And I wouldn't wish that on any parents. I wouldn't wish that on my worst enemy. And I think it makes sense if you might have one of, you know, student leaders of some of them those kids up here and speak to their fellow students and talk to them and say, look, this is not doing any good to anybody. You know, you guys all think this is a great time and it's cool and it's fun to do these things. But this guy's telling you his daughter died, and she made good decisions. Mm-hmm. And I think that you make a valid point in maybe having at least the student leaders here and kids that can get up here as part of the panel and feel more of a part of the thing. That might be a great idea in the future.
And that's fine. But as we said in my meeting before, if there's alcohol present, they need to contact you to say, hey, Ma, come get me. Because bad things happen when you have alcohol and inexperience with it. Never mind someone, you know, adults. I mean, we see it happening every day. But again, we're just very, very concerned with the amount of individuals and the individuals that we keep seeing over and over and over. It's the same core group. It just keeps expanding. And that's what caused us concern. Because I think if it was at that meeting, as I said, this affects everybody. It affects the police department and the fire department. Nothing worse than going to your home at 3 in the morning and telling you your daughter or son's not coming home. It affects us. Never mind, you know, you and the whole community. And, I mean, I'm sure the school would have grief counselors here. We don't want to be there. And, you know, it's like I just said, looking around the room here. Again, I don't have to look far. It's not many of you here. Going back several years ago when Principal Driscoll was here on the on prom night. The reason you have to come here on prom
a week before
to pick up the tickets is because people didn't come and listen about social host. So he changed that up. In order for you to get your children's prom tickets, you have to come and listen to this, whether you like it or not. Because that one night that we did do it, I was here, Andy Lowen, our school resource officer at the time, I think you were here, Captain, mm-hmm. and there was about this many people here. How many people go to the prom?
200. I think just to add, I think we heard that in the fall from a lot of parents that we were targeting only athletes. I know we're having conversations about other groups in the school and making it more equitable. I would also like to tell you that we had a drug theater this year where we had actual students from around the state and their parents put on a play for all our kids. And the kids had an opportunity to ask questions, and it was interactive. We met with the classes individually in the auditorium. We do that all year long. We're going to continue to do that, and I think it's beneficial. I'm going to invite everyone that's here tonight, even if you don't have a child going to prom, if you want to join us on May 19th, which is a social host night. I know Jim's going to come back and tell a story. He's also going to bring a video of something that goes on in court for someone that gets in trouble for drunk driving. It's very powerful. And again, that's a mandatory meeting for all parents in order for them to pick up their tickets for students to go to prom. And I'm glad it's mandatory, and I hope it's always mandatory, because that's really the best way for us to get the message out.
Can I ask a quick question? I know you said Mr. Butcher, right?
Yes.
Coming back to social host night, tied into the prom, what about the younger kids? You know, like our boys are freshmen and sophomores. They're not going to prom. They don't go out on Friday nights. Sometimes it helps to be a little bit of a homebody. But what is, I sat here and listened to your story and you know, to the panel, and I want them to hear that too. I don't want them to wait. Somebody made the comment that it's starting younger and younger. I don't want them to wait to hear that until they're juniors or seniors going off to the prom. I want, obviously I'm gonna go home tonight and they're gonna hear them out, hear an earful. The younger kids need to hear this story, these stories as well, and the consequences and how the schools are working with the police department and the resources available to them at a younger age. I don't know if there was a question there or not.
So I agree, Karen, and I agree also. The kids need a voice, and it's how we get them to feel comfortable to have a voice, because I know exactly what you're saying. They feel like if they speak up, people will leave people against them. And Karen, I think you're absolutely right. When I heard the story too, and I was thinking, yeah, the other kids need to hear this kind of information. So I think it's something that we need to work on.
Mary, you want me here, I'll be here.
Thank you.
I wish more people were at that as well.
So. And how young that they all, these kids, I mean, they're kids.
Mm-hmm.
And how much they are starting.
Go ahead, Mary. Yeah, Patty.
So I think we're a little disappointed that I can't believe how many people are here. Like, this is disturbing to me. But it is a shame that the parents and the students.
If I could just say something too, in my job as a chief probation officer, I mean, we end up with a lot of these kids, probably not your kids, because you people care and you're here. I wish there were a lot more parents like you, and I mean that from the bottom of my heart. I just really do. But the problem is, when they get to me, it's a little late, you know, and when they get to my court, because now the juvenile court's had enough of them. Now they're looking at adult sentences. Now we're getting other people with Gosnold involved in trying to help them break an addiction that started at a very young age, because they didn't come to things like this, because they didn't listen, because they didn't have parents like you who care. And that's the real tragedy. And then it's a much tougher cycle to break. And I think that a lot more parents should come to these things, and I think it's a great thing that Falmouth does with the Social Host Night. I come every year I can, and then I'm invited, and Jim and Mary want me to hear, and I'm coming. I'm part of Cape Cod now. I consider the whole community Cape Cod. I'm from the Dennis Yarmouth area, but I come here because I care about people all over Cape Cod. I don't want to see, you know, Halloween night kids killed. I don't want to see Memorial Day weekend kids killed that are our kids, Cape Cod kids. I don't want to see that. And I, as I said, when they get to my age, if parents aren't concerned like you people are, by the time they get to me, it's a tougher cycle to break. And I think that's why we should, you know, Social Host Night's going to be a good night. I show a great video of a girl being arraigned for motor vehicle homicide who's 19 years old. And it really shakes a lot of people up. And that's what it's intended to do, because that's reality TV. This happened, and you'll see it that night. I didn't bring it tonight because some of you are going to have to be there for that also. But, you know, I'll come here for freshmen and sophomores. I'll come whenever Jim or Mary ask me to come, I'll come. I care that much about your kids and your families. And I think everybody on this panel feels the same way.
Absolutely. So one thing is, as informed parents, what you have to be watching up next is legalization of marijuana in the next election. There's going to be a lot of information out there. We're already trying to rally against that battle. I belong to the Mass Chiefs, and the governor has spoken against it and everything else. That's going to be the next thing coming down the road, folks. And all I can tell you is just be informed. There's going to be a lot of literature out there talking about youth and marijuana, how it affects it. It is much more powerful than the marijuana of our days. So it's going to be the next thing that we'll be discussing. So be informed, parents. Do some reading.
If I could just add really quickly how much I appreciate the parents who came here, and especially the ones who are offering comments saying, I think this is where we could have done better. Over the last couple months, I didn't look at tonight, and I don't think anyone here looked at tonight as a way to say, this is the hard line, this is the way things are, or a chance for us to defend ourselves. This is a chance to continue a conversation that's been happening this year, a conversation that will always happen when you're talking about high school students and the risky behaviors they take. And I also don't think, none of us up here are a single story. We are not just assistant principals or police officers. Many of us are parents. Many of us are parents of children in the community as well. And we take these things to heart, and we hold them very close to our hearts. We're not feeding lip service when we say our greatest concern isn't an athletic suspension, or our greatest concern is not exactly what they were doing so we can punish. Our greatest concern is for the safety of the kids of Falmouth. And I think that's the conversation we want to continue first and foremost, and that's why we're here tonight. So thank you for giving us the feedback to allow us. You wouldn't believe how many of the things you both brought up were said in those first conversations. We echo many of those sentiments, and we are working to grow as well. We understand we can always do better at this.
May I also add that to the mom in the back, I don't want to refer to you that way, but who mentioned the youth being involved in the decision-making process or policies. We also, Gosnold has the Falmouth Prevention Partnership under its umbrella, and we have youth representatives that are part of that coalition, and I would welcome other youth voices. We advocate all the time to have more kids participate. We have a fantastic core group of kids from the Falmouth area that do participate in the activities. And I travel all over the Cape with Gosnold, and I will say, not just because I'm sitting in Falmouth, but it is absolutely one of the most proactive school systems and towns with a police department that's supportive of the community. As you said, we can't start early enough. I mean, I say get the prevention programs in kindergarten, like we did with cigarette smoking. Parents are still the single biggest influence in their kids' lives. That applies even through the teen years. I know we don't think so, but talk and they listen. I agree with you that athletes should not be the only ones targeted. You're absolutely right that the rules go for all. And again, I would welcome, in my role at Gosnold and at the Falmouth Prevention Partnership, any youth that would like to participate in policies that we can change as well. And I'm sure as the police chief would too. So I just wanted to say thank you for bringing that up. Youth-led initiatives are the ones that can really invoke change and bring kids together as well. Not just the parents lecturing. There are a lot of scare tactics out there right now, particularly with the opiate crisis. I stand as the, as I often call my son, as the lone wolf. Scare tactics do not work. Research shows they don't. If they're not coupled with education and with support from other sectors of the community, they simply, it's a one and done. They have a high impact for a few hours, a few days. But we're sitting here tonight. What I like about even this approach is people are coming from all different places, education, support, and wanting that feedback. So again, I invite you to see me. I can give you my card.
Are there any other questions or comments?
I think even what you do, even if it's a small group, I think one student can make a difference. I think we've heard tonight that even kids who make great decisions, like Jim's daughter, I think we're all vulnerable. And I think it's the expression, it takes a village, and we all need to do a part. More parents need to be involved, coaches, education we've talked a lot about in the past, and I think it's going to happen in Falmouth, an education night for parents of athletes. They have to come to attend a mandatory, concussion education and other such things. That can we add drug and alcohol education to that? It may already be a part of the curriculum, so again, no, I don't know if it is already, Jim. But I think it's a multi-pronged approach, and it starts earlier, and it starts with risky behavior. We see behaviors in kids, as the adjustment counselor pointed out, happening at the elementary level. We have a clinician at Mullenhall Elementary School, and it doesn't take a clinician to figure that you see these behaviors starting very, very young. So I think part of the issue is really getting the education younger, even before they get to you, coach, at the high school level, that I think that's been echoed too. And that we give kids more positive things to do, that as a community, as a society, we reward the good behavior, and we don't always focus on the negative. And to know that good kids do make bad decisions, but also wonderful kids get into situations that they shouldn't be in, but they end up that way, and bad things happen. And again, they're all vulnerable. So I think anything that we can all do, I can't preach the younger more than I already do. Earlier is better, and it works, and the research shows that it works. So go home and talk to your kids. The younger, the better. And thank you as a coach for doing what you do for the kids. We don't want to see them in our place. I mean, by the time they get to us, I mean, if addiction as a disease, by the time they get to Gosnell, they're at stage 4 by the time they're inpatient in our place. So we don't want to see that. My job when I took the prevention division, when we started it, I said to the CEO, my job is to put the detox out of business. And he said, nothing would give me greater pleasure than to be in a world where we don't need that anymore, where we don't have enough beds, where we're creating detox beds. How about if we're creating so much money for prevention programs and initiatives that's where the focus is, and not on how to treat a disease that's gotten to a point that maybe we could have prevented to begin with. Once the train leaves the station, whether it's alcohol, marijuana, opiates, or a combination of all of the above, it's at a place where you never want to be. So thank you.
I think this pretty much concludes our evening. I'd like to thank everyone that came tonight. We appreciate your feedback and your questions. I'd like to thank the panel for taking time away from your families to spend this evening here tonight at the high school in conjunction with the police department and just putting the word out there. Thank you.
Thank you.